and hopefully people will join in as we go along. So I want to start from something extremely basic. Again, I'm sure, I hope all of you have taken pens or pencils and papers from here if you do not already have that. Right, so I need to start with something extremely basic, intuition. How many of you feel that you have good intuition, that it has guided you in the right way? Okay, extremely few people. What is intuition? Forget about good intuition or bad intuition. Do any of us even know what is intuition? It's not some magical power. Some people just seem to have better judgment than others, right? So where does this come from?
Experience.
Okay. What else? Okay. You can use...
some of sixth sense.
No, not really sixth sense. What we define intuition as, scientifically it's defined as only two things. If you're good at two things, you will have good intuition. The first is observation. Any guesses what the other thing is? Very close to this gentleman's answer. You have, so intuition essentially has two ingredients, good observation and good pattern matching. Okay, what does pattern matching imply? Okay, I'm going to take a moment. Yeah, please. Like 1 minute ago. Don't worry, you haven't missed anything. So I will revisit my question. What is intuition? To which I gave the answer. Intuition is nothing but good observation plus good pattern matching. You already have some sort of patterns in your head. When you see them being repeated, you match that case and say, you know what, this seems similar to that. Therefore, I can apply the same judgment, the same analysis here. Right? And that pattern making skill comes from experience, comes from a lot of trial and error, comes from everything that you have gone through. Right? Now, bad intuition or bad judgment simply means either you have not observed correctly or the patterns in your head were not right. Perhaps you were prejudiced. Perhaps your experiences were very rare, were very weird. They were not a common case, right? Say, for example, I ask all of you to think of a person. This person comes from North India. He is from a very rich family in North India, right? Take a moment and think of a person who's extremely rich and comes from North India. All of you have an image in your head. All of you have an image in your head. It may or may not be the average of what I am saying. Right? So you have already pattern matched it to an image which was already there in your head. It may be correct. It may be the average case. It may not be the average case. Right? So we need, if we want to have better intuition, we should observe every detail and then correctly pattern match it to whatever we have. Now this is where most problems arise. Why? There is no nicer way of putting it. We are all hypocrites. We are all hypocrites. We all want to be someone unique. If somebody judged you just on the basis of being a North Indian rich person, you would hate them. And yet, when I have given you just two characteristics of a person, all of you have mapped it to an image in your head. We want to be unique, and yet we pattern match people in our heads all the time. Now, the hypocrisy goes deeper. Who is the one person that is the hardest to judge? One person in everyone's life who is the hardest to judge. You can never judge that one person correctly. Who is that person? They don't happen in everybody's life, thankfully. Sorry? Exactly. Exactly. The hardest person to judge is yourself. Why? Again, very well proven, two things. You always have two biases in your mind. The first bias is when you're trying to pick up a professional skill. Say, for example, you're a programmer, you're trying to learn a new language. You have just started on Python, and you are very interested, and you need to learn this well, right? You will always be biased against yourself, and even though for an average person you are already really good at it, you will judge yourself harshly and say, you know what, I know nothing. I need to go deeper. I need to learn better. When you're acquiring a skill, that is what you do to yourself. Everybody does it to yourself. If you have a skill that nobody is forcing on you, lot of skills are forced from a workplace, right? Maybe not for those skills, but if you want to learn a skill, truly want to learn a skill, you will always judge yourself harsher than the average person, right? The second hypocrisy comes in when you judge yourself on character. Say, for example, if I ask you, are you an honest person? Are you an honest person? A good, yeah, exactly. A good majority will say yes. Whereas if somebody does the same deed of dishonesty, say for example, somebody uses their office stationery, somebody else does the same thing, you would judge them far more harshly than you would judge yourself on the same deed. So our hypocrisy is two-edged. We are constantly judging ourselves harshly and leniently, depending upon what we are judging ourselves on. So the hardest person to judge is yourself. If you can judge yourself correctly from a neutral, non-biased point of view, you can apply it to almost anyone, right? Now, as I started with pattern making, this very interesting guy called Carl Jung has this idea about something called archetypes. Any idea what these are? Yeah, archetypes are essentially templates. Yeah, they are essentially templates. And Carl Jung was of this view that there are only 12 or 20 types of people. You are all from the same one of those 12 templates. And you are one instance of that template, okay? Say for example, he took his inspiration from literature because they say that art imitates life. So he took his inspiration from literature and said that these archetypes can be further given. If you are a very normal archetype, you become a stereotype. If you are the best possible example of your archetype, you become an epitome. Yeah? So, he said that there are only about one dozen sort of people in this world. Say, for example, if you take the example of any good literature, if any of you read a lot of books, read a lot of fiction particularly? Yeah. Okay. So, in fiction, there's a very reoccurring theme that you have. One second. That you have an orphan child and orphan child who grows up to become a hero or a heroine, who grows up to become a mentor. Now, orphan child, hero and mentor are all stereotypes or archetypes. And what you see examples in different literatures are simply one possible instance of these three. Say for example, Harry Potter is an orphan child who grows up to become a hero. Simplest possible example, yeah? So you have some sort of a rite of passage. To convert from one form to another, right? Around the same time, now this theory was not really well accepted. Why? Again, hypocrisy. Everyone wants to be a unique sample. So people took really offense to the statement that, you know, there are only 12 types of people in the world. People were like, no, I am unique. No. So that didn't work out too well, but in hindsight it makes a lot of sense. In hindsight it makes a lot of sense. Now there was also this very, perhaps the most well-known psychologist of all time, Freud, who said that there are three components to your personality. There is the id, the ego, and the superego. Again, to put it in very crude words, id is your base part. That means your very basic needs of food, of power, of love. The basic needs of every human being come under id. One, until this is fulfilled, the other two are not going to function. Nobody has morals on an empty stomach. Yeah? So id is your base nature. The nature that wants fulfillment, it's your basic human need for power, for love, for good living conditions, etc. Now, ego is slightly more refined. This is the part that lives in present. Your id has been satisfied. So you start expressing your own talents, what you really are, etc. That comes under your ego. Your superego is the nicest part of you. It's the altruistic giving nature, where you want to help others, where you can rise above yourself and think. Okay? So these two were the two base theories that I have given you. Neither of these is taken on its face value today in psychoanalysis. Why? First problem, in archetypes, you're not one person at a time. You're not just the hero. You don't have to go through a rite of passage to become a mentor. You can be a hero, a mentor, and an orphan child all at the same time in three different stories. Because you meet hundreds of people every day, and you fill a different role to each and every one of them. Yeah? So there is no rite of passage involved. You're all of these all at the same time. Okay? If you go through a rite of passage, yes, you will experience a few changes within yourself, perhaps. So these are not just, you're not a static being. You may have started out as something, you might be something in a different instance of time, with interacting with a different set of people. That's exactly what I'm trying to say. You are going to change from one archetype to another, depending upon the situation, depending upon the time, what you have gone through. Right? Now, it comes to identifying patterns. Yeah? What we are trying to do is trying to fit each and every one of us in these given patterns, right? We are trying to see which part of our personality is more active and hopefully our imaginative, nice, altruistic, caregiver part is the more dominant part of our personality. Perhaps that's what we want to achieve. Different people want to achieve different things from their personality, don't they? So, not my job to tell you which one of these to follow, but these were the initial ideas and they still influence psychology as it is studied today. Now, since we need to see patterns, first of all, I will give you three disclaimers. Firstly, I do not have a degree in psychology. This is all self-taught. This is what I have taught myself. Secondly, if you go to most websites, they will categorize most type of psychoanalysis, including graphology, as a pseudoscience. And there are two reasons for that. Firstly, it is extremely poorly practiced. People practice graphology like occult, like palmistry, handwriting, or, you know, telling future from the stars. It's completely unscientific. Secondly, it's a very young science, so research is still ongoing in this. And there is not enough reliable literature that you can look at. Okay? So yes, this is still, in most categorizations, this is still classified as a pseudoscience. The third disclaimer is that all that I'm going to present to you now, you will have to follow the scientific method for yourself. Whatever I have learned, I have taken hundreds and hundreds of handwriting samples and I have found these things out for myself. Yes, I have referred to a lot of books, but I have not taken any of those on their face value. FBI has followed graphology to a great extent. They have used it to solve criminal cases. We are not going to do anything quite so complicated. Yeah. In India, graphology has a very ambivalent state. It's not a crime. In certain European countries, such as Hungary, if you graphoanalyze somebody without his consent, it is taken as a breach of privacy and is an offense, is a criminal offense. In India, there is no such law like that. In United States, graphology can be used as evidence against a person, testifying that this person is not sound of mind. In India, there is no mechanism like that either. The only thing that we use graphology for is to detect forgery, if you have faked somebody's signature, right? That is the only case where graphology can be used in the Indian court of law. Otherwise, it has no legal standpoint in India whatsoever. Okay? So anyway, now I have studied a lot of handwritings, and it makes sense. Why? Because your hands are connected to the same brain that thinks. Yeah? You know that when somebody is sad, their whole demeanor changes, right? They walk slower, they look sad. So there's a very, very logical consequence that if you are in a certain mood or if you are a certain type of person, it will reflect in your body language. Then why not here? Right? It should reflect in your handwriting as well. It's the same brain controlling your hand. Now, there's a lot of literature available from FBI files. If you really want good literature on handwriting, please take one of those people who has actually done handwriting analysis for FBI and read their books. At least you'll have a good starting point. But there is one problem to that, is that most of those authors are American. Difference between here and there, two major differences. Firstly, their grip is different. They hold their pens like this. If you have friends who have been taught abroad or who are not Indian by birth, you would have seen that people from different schooling hold their hands very differently from us. And that makes their entire handwriting slightly different from us. Okay. Second difference, most Americans read and write only English. They're monolingual. That is not the case with us. Now, I am guessing that most of you write at least one Indian language. Yeah? My mother tongue is Hindi, so I'm just going to demonstrate. If you write in English, your hand moves like this, anti-clockwise. Yeah? Anti-clockwise strokes. Whereas if you write in an Indian language, clockwise strokes. Yeah? The base of English alphabet is an oval. The base of Indian alphabet is circle. Yeah? Indian languages do not have any capital letters whatsoever. And all our alphabets are joined on at the top. Yeah? So all those, if you are more fluent in your mother tongue than in English, you are going to write English with an Indian accent. Yeah. So please take that into account. In American writing systems, round strokes are considered very childish and immature. You are not immature, you are simply Indian. So why are they considered immature? Why are they considered immature? Have you seen a child's handwriting? A child who's about 3 or 4 or 5 years old, who's very new to English and he's just beginning to write, they will write big round letters like this. Yeah? Children write like that. Children have the more close to oval you get, sharp strokes, harsh strokes cannot be done without tensing your muscles. Children are happy people. They don't tense their muscles that often. So the more round a writing is, the more childish it looks, because children write large round letters. Yeah? So all of you, I hope, have some sort of a pen or pencil or writing instrument and a paper in front of you. If you don't, please take a paper from this notebook and take a pen. Share pens if you have to. A few quick exercises, since we have not a very long time, but few quick exercises. Take the unlined paper. Yeah. So I hope everyone's got a piece of paper and a pen or pencil of some sort in your most natural handwriting. whatever. English. Any three lines. Whatever you like. Yeah. Any three sentences? In your most natural, normal handwriting. Once you are done with that, write the same three lines as fast as you possibly can. Without hurting your hand, write those things as fast as you possibly can.
Imposition?
Yeah. Those who are short on ideas, yes? Okay, great. Those who are short on ideas. Jumps over the lazy dog. Yeah, so if you're out of ideas what to write, you can write this. This covers pretty much the entire English alphabet, all 26 alphabets there in this line. So if you're out of ideas as to what to write, you can write this. Okay, a lot of you have finished writing? Yeah? So, notice this. If you have a simple piece of paper, whatever you write in your natural line goes like this. When you write the same thing fast, your right margin tends to shift like this. Of course, I have exaggerated this, yes, but this is natural because English goes from left to right, right? So when you're trying to be fast, this is what happens naturally unless you're given a margin on your paper, right? So what would you infer about a person who has this margin all the time? Yeah, so the bad part, he's hurried, he's impulsive. The good part, he can think really fast. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So this happens naturally when you're trying to write really, really fast.
Or
writing a program with your hands, not with a keyboard. With a pen and a pencil, this happens when you're not given a margin and you write really fast. So if somebody writes like this all the time, they have been writing fast all the time. This can mean two things. A, they think really fast. Slow thinkers will never have this writing. And B, they are impulsive. They don't really stop to think about anything. Yeah? So, one inference. Similarly, what happens if you are in a lecture and you're really bored? You have to write, but you're really bored. You don't really want to write it down. Your hands will start... Yeah, you will lose the pressure with which you're holding your pen. Your writing will become lighter and lighter. Okay, so that's one way of checking if the person was serious writing it or not. If it was written heavily, the person was focusing, was concentrating. Yeah, yeah. Now, this is also a very common check for forgery. If you're trying to copy a signature, your thickness, your pressure would be far greater than the actual person's because you are concentrating a lot. Whereas the person who actually wrote the signature, it's very natural for him. Why would he apply so much pressure, right? So forgery, that's one of the very simple checks, rather very preliminary checks for forgery. That given the same pen, the same signature looks too heavy. Yeah? And that's also because when you're concentrating on something, your pen will be very heavy-handed. So what inference for a person whose writing is always heavy-handed? He focuses. He's really concentrated on the job. Bad part, of course, he is not
constant. Or his hand is really heavy. And
actually, that's more possible for the converse part. That's more possible for the converse part. If somebody is writing with a really light hand, check with them if they have an injury.
Sunny Dior, next time.
Yeah. When you have a hand injury, obviously you're not going to be able to write with the same pressure. So if somebody has written really lightly, don't jump into the conclusion that they were not interested. Please check whether they have an injury in their hands. Okay. So that's one very simple check for boredom. The first thing, your pressure goes off. What is the second thing? Come on, we've all taken lectures in boring class. Yes, your spacing between alphabet goes like this. This whole phenomena is called threading. Yeah, you threading and waving.
What waving?
You make waves like this instead of writing proper alphabets. In both cases, you are losing actual alphabets.
Is it threading and waving?
Waving. Yeah. Unfortunately, no. But that's how you lose alphabets. When you're not concentrating, you try to look like you've written something, but actually it's just gibberish. Okay? So that's what happens when you lose focus and you lose concentration.
But the same thing can happen in case I'm writing in a hurry. I would
in exams,
maybe
in exams last 5 minutes.
Yeah, but in that case, your pressure would go off. If you're writing in a hurry, but you're still focused, yes, your handwriting will look messy. And yes, you will kind of, you know, try to write as much as possible, but your pressure would still be there. You will still write with the same heaviness. In fact, if you're writing really fast, you will write with more pressure. Because you're really concentrated on getting the job done.
This pressure thing comes when you're writing with ballpoint pen. Suppose if you're writing...
It would still be there. Yeah.
Yeah. LinkedIn, okay, it will come back. So suppose if you give a white paper to anyone from here,
okay,
and ask him to write in a...
Okay, paper. I'll check on that. but the choice of pen does really matter, especially when you're checking for forgery. There are dozens of countries around the world which do not accept your signature if you have signed it with a sketch pen, felt tip pen, because it's impossible to tell pressure on a felt tip pen, on a sketch pen. So yes, that is what forgers use a whole lot of time to guise their pressure. Use a pen that doesn't show any pressure difference anyway. Yeah, so that is a good forger's tool. Kudos to him for pointing that out. But
I used to do in my progress.
But for legal documents, you can't use a fountain tip pen or a gel pen. That's what I know.
Yes.
You cannot use.
Yes, exactly.
You have to use a ballpoint pen.
Exactly, and that is what they are for. Because other sorts of pens simply erase any difference in pressure. You cannot tell when you're using a pen like that. Anyway, can anybody please tell me how much time we have got left? Because I want you guys to check out a few more things. 15 more minutes, okay. So, what would be the converse case? If somebody's natural handwriting goes like this. Okay, yes, slow thinker, thinking a lot before writing.
Or they write another script naturally. It could be that too, right?
Yes, yes, yes. Perhaps their mother tongue is Hebrew or something written in Arabic script. Yes, one of the possible causes. Barring that, it is generally the sign of a slow thinker, somebody who takes a lot of time to reach a decision, generally. Was when I gave a person paper lined like this, and he wrote like this. So immediately you can infer that it's a very rebellious person. He's not going to follow any given rules or problems. So, but no, lined paper again forces your baseline to become constant, right? I did not want that to happen because all of us have a certain natural baseline. Yeah, most people would like to think that. No.
What if we give in the plain paper without
any... Yeah, anyway. So, you can have three or four cases. The first is that your natural handwriting is very stable and goes very straight.
The second one is it goes straight up. The second one is straight down, kind of like a convex or concave curve, or totally wavy. Okay, so you compensate your tendencies. Anyway. Okay. Okay. So essentially, again, make a logical inference. If somebody's natural handwriting is that neat and that straight baseline, yes, they have a good command over their mind. They are very stable people, nice, grounded people. What if somebody's handwriting goes up like this?
Their handwriting is bad.
You can have perfectly beautiful handwriting that climbs up a hill.
They are forward thinkers.
Yes, sort of. Well, it's usually taken to be a sign of optimism. Try it out on yourself. I can't ask you to try it out because I need a very solid variation of mood. In that, when you are feeling a little happier, your handwriting will naturally go up. Try it on yourself when you are feeling particularly happy.
I have one doubt.
Sure.
If it is the reverse.
Okay. Make a guess.
Don't get me wrong, okay?
Sure.
I recently became blind.
Okay.
But when I was very young, my mom used to say, not even Brahma will understand what you write.
A lot of people would say that, but you know what? It doesn't really matter.
I can't even sign right now, you know.
It's okay.
That's a problem.
Messiness is not what,
so
what you...
What do you judge me with that? I'm rebellious?
No.
Slow thinker?
Not at all.
No, medical reports show that.
Yeah. There is a stereotype of people being creative messes. And that's a stereotype for a good reason.
Okay.
Yeah? Creative people tend to be a little messy in one area of life or the other. Perhaps you were expressing that, I don't know. Yeah, but the messiness of your handwriting is not what you are analyzed on.
But what if someone is of absolute sound mind?
Yes.
And it's just in the area of handwriting, they're absolutely messy. So then graphology wouldn't really...
Good graphologists won't. You're not judged on the neatness of your handwriting.
Hmm.
You're judged on particular traits. Right? You could have a margin like this and you could have still written beautifully. I'm not concerned with how beautifully you've written here. Yes? Okay? So messiness does not matter. Okay, some people are messy by nature.
No,
sometimes it shows up in their hair. Sometimes it shows up in their handwriting. Doesn't matter.
I tried to
go
here today.
Exactly. That's why most people who judge on graphology do it anonymously. Yeah. They don't tell you that they're going to analyze you.
No, but wouldn't you rather take a sample from stuff that I've already written?
Yes, that would be better. Generally, the most reliable source of a sample for this would be somebody's diary. You're absolutely true to yourself in that. There is no pressure. You're writing exactly what you feel. Yeah?
No, but then it depends on the mood.
Psychologist, parent, patient confidentiality and all those
but
things.
It depends upon the mood also.
Of course. Your handwriting should change with your mood. And a normal person should have at least 3 to 4 different handwritings. That is absolutely normal and that is what should happen. Just as you're not the same person to everyone, your handwriting should not also be something static and dead. It should be as alive as you are.
So then the understanding and the analysis changes according to the mood also, right? So
absolutely. You should be able to judge what is just a mood and what is the core personality. That comes with a lot of experience. You will have to see hundreds of handwritings when
and
you get to that.
Doubt.
Yeah.
The pattern is dependent on the angle where you are putting the paper. So
absolutely. Absolutely.
So
absolutely.
Consider my handwriting.
So when you are taking a sample, take it from people who have written in very comfortable surroundings, essentially their most natural handwriting. That is why I keep repeating, please write in your most natural handwriting. Right? So, of course, if you have angled your paper, if you're crammed into one of those horrible college tests with one little...
Yeah.
Even if you are the most sad, depressed person in the world, your handwriting... rating is going to go up. There is no other choice left, right? Yeah. So please take samples written when the writer is completely as at ease. You want them feeling completely natural. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. So again, these are my inferences. Please go through more handwritings. Experiment on yourself how your handwriting changes as your mood changes. Generally, when you are happy, it tends to climb up. Generally.
Can I test it on myself? Because
absolutely.
I've been testing on myself. So.
Again, you require a certain degree of detachment. Yes. But it's best to, when you are in certain different moods, try writing when you are seriously hungry. It will come out bad. So try writing in different moods. When you feel that you have if you have old notebooks from your teenagers or from significant amount of time past, go and see how much you have grown as a person.
That's why I don't always complete my notebooks.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not a matter of completion. Your handwriting would have changed significantly many times over the years. And that is because you are changing as a person. You are growing as a person. Your handwriting has grown with you. And it is for good reason. So take your own samples. You know, inside your heart, you know what you were 10 years ago and what you are right now. Compare that. Compare your maturity level. Compare how you have grown as a person. Were there some things better back then? Would you like to be more tension-free or whatever? And all those traits, compare your own handwriting from different time frames, from different moods, and then form your own analysis. Then try it on somebody else. Once you have a solid faith in what you are doing to yourself, then try it out on other people. Okay, I think we have to stop now.
Okay,
so thank you.
The inferences that you have drawn are very obvious to the, like, if it is
yes.
going forward, it is. So is it like really that way to connect
absolutely.
The behavior between?
Absolutely. It is that obvious. Tense your muscles, you will make more angular strokes. It is all very
forward,
logical.
Backward.
Yes, all
is very
logical.
Obvious?
Yes, and I have to keep things very obvious because this is the first and the last time I get to see you people. If you were people who had a background in psychology or graphology, of course I would have taken it further. Yes. Sorry? Yes, absolutely. Okay. We have 10 minutes. So, yes, to answer his question, we do see individual characters and how you form them as well.
Relevant of the mood, that is something...
Exactly. Just like in your personality, what you behave like is dependent upon two things. One, what you really are and what you are feeling like in that moment. That reflects in your handwriting as well. Some characteristics are based to you that have not changed over the years. And some which are momentarily dependent upon your mood. Yeah? So, that is why I asked you to take a lot of samples, compare them, see how they differ, try to infer how they differ, and try to do it as many times as possible. Try to contradict yourself. Somehow, okay, since English is written in this way, it usually, most of the people either write like this or with a slight slant towards the right. Again, I have exaggerated it significantly to show it properly. Very few people have a slant on the leaning on the left.
What
yeah? For the simple reason, most people will hurt their hands if they try to write with a left slant. It's not very natural, right? Yeah.
No, but some
yeah.
people do that naturally.
Again. Please check if your writer is left-handed. In that case, yes, that would be natural. If not, this is some person which is deliberately trying to take on a slant which does not come very naturally. And this is one slant practiced by most rebellious teenagers. Whoever is going through an angsty, rebellious teenager phase, they tend to try a back slant, so as to speak, a left slant. Very, very few adults have this. The people either have a straight, no slant whatsoever, or slightly leaning towards the right. It's because it's not natural to English. Maybe to other languages which are written in that way. But if you're writing English with a black slant, it is generally restrained to angsty feeling teenagers who are trying very hard to be somebody they are not.
Is it possible that something you picked up while you were rebellious stays on.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
But then it is
your decision to have kept that trait in your personality, is it not? It was your decision to keep that trait in your personality.
Yeah.
So what was a momentary phase for a lot of people has become a part of you now.
Okay, what if, for example, if I write in a ruled paper, if the lines all, everything goes correct.
Yeah.
What if a same person write in a plain paper?
They'll get to know themselves better.
Okay, and is this for specific letters or is it for any alphabet?
I have started trying it out on Indian languages that come next.
In English.
Yes.
In my case, I write P with a backslash, but T with the forward slash.
Then take the majority. Majority of your alphabets are forward or backward leaning.
Okay?
Yeah?
Does your handwriting change as you grow?
Yes, absolutely. Because you are changing as you grow. You are inculcating life experiences which are changing you. You are not the same person as you were in college, are you? I mean, if you are, then good for you, kudos, but most people are not. Most people change immensely as they grow. Statistical study does not attach a cause to it. Here, you're finding a cause that is not just statistical, that also matches with the brain activity of the person. Yes. I can't bring a CAT scan machine here. I can show you that happier people, like their brain light up in a certain area and then their handwriting goes up. That happens. Yeah. Yes, absolutely. The only thing, I told you the point of differences between Indian languages. First of all, for us, we don't join at the bottom like English. It's all joined at the top, right? And plus, there are no capital. There is no capitalization, so you can't judge capital letters differently and those things are pretty universal. Yeah, there are good beginner books, which is one is written by Andrea McNichol. This is from where I started. It's great, but again, please keep in mind this is written by an American, so it will have that monolingual bias for everything and anything else.
So any Indian book is
good. Sorry, Indian books, I would not recommend them, just not reliable. I'm sorry to say this. If you want me to do an analysis of any handwriting, please mail me with a good high quality picture and I might be able to help you.
High quality picture of our
handwriting that you need to analyze.
Scanned picture.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Of course. See, if somebody is born naturally left-handed and you force them to become right-handed, for a very long time, it will be very painful. And that will show.
But what I see is there's drastic difference in the way
See, you are born with a dominant hand for a reason. One part of your brain is dominating over the other. If you are forcibly pushing the other part to write, you are doing something very painful to yourself. Okay? Of course, that's one.